Hello everyone, welcome to Talent Battle. In this video, we are going to discuss some more pseudocode examples to prepare you for recruitment test. If you haven't watched part 1 of this video, link of that is given in description box below. So do check that out and subscribe to our YouTube channel to never miss any placement update. Alright, so let us begin. Here is the first question. Predict the output of the following pseudocode for n is equal to 243 and b is equal to 0. This pseudocode is given in which one function is given. The name of the function is abc. The return type of function is integer and it takes two parameters, integer n and integer b. So in this function, first of all, a variable a is declared of type integer. Now in this if condition, if n is greater than 0, these two statements are given, and in this return statement, as you can see, this abc function is called recursively. Alright, so whenever such kind of recursion example is there, we have to draw function frames. Alright, so I'm just drawing this function frame here. Now for this function, value of n is 243. And value of b is 0. After that, in this function, value of n is definitely greater than 0 because it is 243. So we are going to execute these statements. First statement is a is equal to n mod 10. Now n mod 10 means 243 mod 10. So value of a will be 3 in this case. Okay, so I will just write down here a is equal to 3. And after that, this return statement is there. So in the return statement, we are calling this abc function recursively. Now the parameter values for this function call, first of those parameters is n divided by 10. So 243 divided by 10, that value would be 24. And second parameter is b plus a. Now value of b we have right now is 0 and value of a is 3, so 0 plus 3 would be 3. So this next function would be called. Okay. Now for this next function, value of n we have is 24, then value of b we have is 3. Again, as the value of n is greater than 0, we are going to execute this if condition, that is a is equal to n mod 10. So 24 mod 10 would be 4. So value of a is 4. And we are again calling this abc function call in return statement. So I will just write down here return abc of n divided by 10 in this case would be 2. And b plus a in this case would be 4 plus 3, that is 7. Now for this next function call, value of n would be 2, then value of b is 7, and after that, as value of n is greater than 0, we are going to execute this if condition again. So a is equal to n mod 10. In this case, it would become 2 mod 10. So value of a will be 2. And in this return statement now, next function call, values of parameters would be n divided by 10, that is 2 divided by 10 is 0. And second parameter is b plus a, so that b plus a value would be 7 plus 2, that is nothing but 9. So we make next function call here. Alright, so in this next function now, value of n, as you can see, is 0, value of b is 9. Okay, so in this particular function, this if condition statement is not true because value of n is 0, so 0 greater than 0 is false. So we are going to execute this else part, that is return b. So we are going to return 9 from this function. So I'm just writing it down here. Okay, so from this function we returned 9 to earlier function. Okay, so this whole statement in earlier function, that is return abc of 0, 9, would now become just return 9. Okay, so we are returning 9 from this function to earlier function. the value for this abc of 2, 7 function call would be substituted as 9, so this will again become return 9. Okay, so we are returning 9 from this function to earlier function, and here also this would become return 9. Alright, so we are returning 9 from our very first function, and that is why 9 would be the answer for this particular question. Next question, predict the output of following pseudocode for A is equal to 10 and B is equal to 6. So this FUNC function is given with two parameters, that is integer A and integer B. And in this function, this temp variable is declared. After that, in this while loop, the first statement is temp is equal to A mod B. So as all of you know, that mod operator is used to find out the remainder. So in first case, this value of A initially is 10 and value of B is 6. So value of temp will be 10 mod 6, that is nothing but 4. All right, so temp is equal to 4. After that, we are assigning value of B to A, so A will become 6 now. And after that, finally, we are doing B is equal to temp, so we are assigning temp value to B, so value of B would now become 4. Alright, in the next iteration of this while loop, remember the condition for this while loop is while B, so until and unless value of B is not 0, we are going to continue iterate through this while loop. So for the next iteration, we are again doing temp is equal to A mod B. So A mod B in this case would become 6 mod 4. So value of 6 mod 4 is 2. Okay, so temp value is 2 now. After that, next statement is we are assigning value of B to A. So A would become 4 now. And after that, finally, we are assigning value of temp to B variable. So value of temp right now is 2. So assigning that value to B, so B will now become 2. Okay, so after this iteration, value of A is 4, value of B is 2, and value of temp is 2. After that, in next iteration, again, we are doing temp is equal to A mod B. So A mod B value now would be 4 mod 2. So 4 mod 2 is 0. So that is why value of temp would be 0 now. Next step, assigning value of B to A. So that would make A as 2. And finally, assigning value of temp to B. So value of B will now become 0. Alright, so after this iteration, value of A is 2, value of B is 0, and value of temp is 0. Now for next iteration, as you can see, value of B is now 0. So this while B condition will not hold true. So we will exit from this while loop. And at the end of this pseudocode, we are just returning the value of A. Alright, so as you can see, value of A here is 2. So that is why this 2 is our right answer, option B. Next question. This question is little different. Question statement is, if aim of the pseudocode is to find whether a given number is prime or not, then identify the mistake in below pseudocode. Alright, so in this pseudocode, first statement is read the value of n, that is we are taking input for n value, and condition that is written here is n value will be greater than 1. Okay, so after that, next statement, we are setting value of integer I to 2. And in this while loop, the logic for finding out whether a given number is prime or not is written. So while I is less than n, in this while loop, in this if condition, we are checking whether n is divisible by I. And if it is divisible by I, we are printing not prime. And in else part, we are printing it as prime. And finally, we are just incrementing the value of I by 1. So we have to find the error in this pseudocode. Now in this pseudocode, as you can see, whenever our number n would be divisible by any value I which is less than n, we can directly print that that number is not prime, okay? Because prime numbers would not be divisible by any number less than it. So we can directly print that it is not prime in that case. But if this n number is not divisible by a particular value of I, that is this else part, then we cannot directly print that it is prime. We can only confirm that that n value is prime only after completing this while loop. Okay, so only after checking for all values of I that n is not divisible by that I value, then only we can be sure that our number n is a prime number. So that is why this printing of prime statement should come at end of this while loop. All right, so that is why there is no error on this line number 4 and 5, but there is this definite error on this line number 7. So that is why the output for this particular question would be option B, that is there is mistake on line number 7. Okay, so this is not any compiler error or runtime error. This is just the error in the logic of the code. Next question, predict the output of following C code. So this is not a pseudocode, this is the program in C language. So just by overlooking this program, one might make a mistake that this for loop, this outer for loop is iterating from I is equal to 0 till I is less than 5, and this nested for loop is also iterating from J is equal to 0 till J is less than 5. So one might make mistake that overall this innermost statement, that is count is equal to count plus 1 statement, would execute for 25 times. So that is why the final printing of count value would give output as 25. But that is not the case, because if you notice, after this very first for loop there is this semicolon. Okay, so these below statements are not part of this outer for loop. This for loop would iterate for 5 times. It will just only increment the value of I and then exit from this for loop. And these next curly braces are not part of the for loop. Okay, this is just a different independent block of code. Even if this block is not part of the outer for loop, still it would get executed. So inside this block of code, we are running this inner for loop, that is for int j is equal to 0 till j is less than 5. And this for loop will definitely iterate for 5 times, because there is no any semicolon in front of this. So that is why this statement, that is count is equal to count plus 1, that would also get executed for 5 times. And we are incrementing the value of count by 1. Initially count was set at 0. So that is why after the end of this program, we are printing the value of count, and that value would be 5. So this A option is the right answer. Next question, what will be the output of following pseudocode for input PQR? So here is this function fun. In this we have parameter character array named as A. Now in this function there is very first if condition, that is if A of 0 equals null, then we are just returning from this function. And if this condition is not true, then we would directly execute these recursive function calls. There are two recursive function calls made, fun of A plus 1 and fun of A plus 1. So both the recursive function calls are similar to each other. So first thing first, whenever these kind of recursive calls are made, we will start by drawing the function frame. So for very first function, value of this A character array is PQR. Alright, and in this case A of 0 equals null condition is not true, because value of A of 0 in this case would be P. Okay, so we are going to directly execute this statement, that is fun of A plus 1. So I am writing this statement here, fun of A plus 1. And after that, next statement is fun of A plus 1 again. So I am writing it down here again. And at the end, we are printing the value of A of 0. Alright, so this is our first function frame. So in this function, for this very first function call fun of a plus 1, a next function would get called. Now for this next function, what would be the value of our character array a? Now as you can see, in our previous function we are passing this parameter as a plus 1. So if you know the basics of pointers and array in C language, you can guess that the value of our character array a for the next function would be just qr, because we are incrementing the base address for this character array a. Now in this next function frame again, our a of 0 is not equal to null, so we are just going to directly execute these statements, that is function of a plus 1 and again fun of a plus 1, and after that we are printing the value of a of 0. So the order in which these statements would get executed, it's first of all the next function call would be made. So again for this next function, now value of our character array a would be just r. Now for this first function call from this function, that is fun of a plus 1, when we will call the next function, then now the value of our character array a would be null. So that is why from in this case our a of 0 equals null, this if condition holds true. So we will just return from this particular function. Remember that return type for this fun function is void, it is not given, so we would assume it is void. So that is why this return statement is not returning any value, it is just terminating the execution of this function copy. Okay, so we are just going to return from this function, and the execution of this function is now complete. After returning from this function, in this earlier function we will now execute this next fun of a plus 1 call. Okay, remember we have these two function calls in every function, fun of a plus 1 and fun of a plus 1. So for this next function call, fun of a plus 1 also, we will call the similar copy of the function, where again value of our character array a would be null. So it will again just return from this function. Alright, so after returning from this function, now there are no more function calls in earlier function, so we will just print the value of a of 0. So in this case, value of a of 0 would be r. So our very first letter in the output would be r. Alright, and after printing this r, the execution of this function is also complete, so I am just erasing it here. So let's come to the function prior to it. Now in this second function copy, the execution of this first function call fun of a plus 1 is now complete, and after this this second function call would be made, second function call for fun of a plus 1. Now as you can notice here that the similar type of functions will get called again, for which we have already know the output, that letter r would get printed. So for this second function call fun of a plus 1 also, after executing it we will get 1 r letter printed. So that is why I have written this rr here, and execution for this second fun of a plus 1 call is also complete now, and finally we are printing value of a of 0 for this function. Now as you can see, the character array a in this function has string qr, so a of 0 for this function is q, so we will print q here, and after printing q, the execution of this function copy is also complete. So we come back to our very first function frame. Here the execution of the very first function call fun of a plus 1 is now complete. Okay, so after that we are going to execute this second function call fun of a plus 1. Now again, this fun of a plus 1 function call would generate the similar function frames we have just seen. So whatever was the output output for the first function call, the same output would be there for this second function call fun of a plus 1 as well. So output for first function call fun of a plus 1 was RRQ. So this RRQ output would be repeated for second function call also. So I am writing it down here. And finally, after executing this second function call, we are printing the value of a of 0 for this function frame. Now in this case, our value of character array a is pqr. So a of 0 in this case is letter p. So that is why we would just print the letter p at the end. And after that, execution of this function frame is also complete. And overall execution of our pseudocode will get complete. So we have in our output this particular stream of characters, that is RRQ, RRQ, P. If you check it with the options, this option B is the correct answer. Next question. Again, this is a little different question. The statement is, what does the following piece of code do? We have given this function FUNC, in which we have a parameter as tree class and the name of the variable is root. And the overall syntax of the statements, if you see, this is the code in Java language. So first of all, we are printing the this root dot data. After that, we are calling this FUNC function again, and we are passing the parameter as root dot left. And again, after that, we are calling this FUNC function again, and this time we are passing the parameter as root dot right. Alright, so if you know the basic data structures and especially the tree data structure, it is very easy to identify that this is the pre-order traversal of a tree. In tree also, it is specific to a binary search tree. Next question. Pseudocode to sort given array in ascending order is given, and we have to find error in the logic of this pseudocode. The very first statement is, we are taking input for size of array. After that, we are taking input for all the elements of array. And in this below two for loops, so the logic for sorting the array in ascending order is given. All right. And at the end of this pseudocode, these options are given, that is line 4, line 6, line 7 or no error. We have to find out at which particular line of code the mistake in the logic of the program is present. The lines which are already given in the options are written in this bold font. So while solving this problem, it is a wise decision to just focus on these particular lines and the operations which are happening on that particular line of code. So the very first thing we are doing is, we are running this while loop when value of I is less than value of size. All right. So suppose we have our array A as 4, 8, 3, 20. So there is no harm done if we are running our first loop till the end of the loop, that is till value of I is less than value of size. So there is no mistake in this first statement. After that, on next statement, we are doing j is equal to I plus 1. So initially, if value of I was 0 and I was pointing to this very first element, then j is equal to I plus 1 means j is pointing to this particular position. And in this next nested while loop, we are running this loop till value of j is less than size. So we are running this j loop from this particular position till the last position. Alright, so again, there is no mistake in this particular statement also. So far the logic is correct. Now next statement is, if array of I, if a of I is less than a of j, then we are swapping the values at those particular indices. Okay, so if you see in this particular case, our a of I value would be 4 and our a of j value is 8, and a of I is indeed less than a of j. So this if condition holds true and we would end up swapping these two values. So our array will now become 8, 4, 3 and 20. Okay, so if you notice that this value 4 is less than 8, and we have swapped this value, and this 4 is now come at the second position. So this is something very wrong. The smaller value 4 should have stayed at its position itself. This swapping of these two values was unnecessary. So this particular statement, that is, if a of I is less than a of j, then swap the values at present at the indices I and j, is wrong. Instead, this statement should have been, if a of I is greater than a of j, then swap the values at that positions. Okay, so this was the right statement and this is the wrong statement. So the option which points to this line of code, that is line number 7, is the right answer, and it is option C. Now, while preparing for the pseudocode round, it is always wise to read the rules for writing pseudocode and learn about theory of the pseudocode also. So let us see these couple of questions to understand what kind of questions can be asked based on that. So first question is, capitalize initial keyword. This is a rule while writing a pseudocode, and we have to state whether this statement is true or false. So if we know the theory of writing pseudocode, we know that this statement is true. So this option A would be the correct answer. Next question is, dash dash is used to show hierarchy in a pseudocode. So if you have observed the pseudocode that we have solved up till now, then indentation is used to show the hierarchy. Curly braces are typically used to show the hierarchy in C language. And these round brackets and colon are also not used anywhere in pseudocode. So this A option, that is indentation, is the correct answer. Alright, so these were just the sample questions that can be asked based on the theory of writing pseudocode. So while preparing for the pseudocode round, make sure that you learn about rules of writing pseudocode as well.